what a journey to the core of solar system planets would look like. In Jules Verne's famous novel, Journey to the Center of the Earth, the protagonists of that incredible adventure made it to the heart of our planet by traversing forests grown in great hollows, rivers of lava, and lakes of water, and escaping the pitfalls of a real underworld populated by prehistoric creatures. Just a good story, of course. How could Jules Verne have known, in fact, in the 19th century, what the interior of the Earth looked like? In our time, fortunately, we know a lot more. No descents down endless caverns, then no chasms in the center of the Earth. No inner worlds, subterranean seas, dinosaurs, or cavemen. The Earth is a compact sphere filled with materials at very high temperatures. Yeah, but are we really sure? And how do we know? After all, the maximum depth reached by a borehole is 12 kilometers, or only 500th part of the Earth's radius, a mere nothing. Yet, that's just the way it is. By now, we can say that we have a very good knowledge of what lies beneath the Earth's crust, and a fair knowledge of the internal composition of the other planets in the solar system. Strange, isn't it? And how would we have done that? With what magic wand would we have succeeded? What do you say? Let's try together to figure it out. Apart from boreholes, which are totally insufficient for the purpose, astronomers have many other tools to probe the interior of planets. By carefully observing the rotation of a planet, for example, it's possible to detect the presence of very small oscillations of its axis of rotation, and the amount and magnitude of these oscillations depend on a parameter called the moment of inertia, which can give useful insights into how mass is distributed within the planet. The cores of Earth-type planets, to say, are much denser than their surface crust, and Jovian planets have an even greater concentration of mass in their cores. Small twists in the rotation of an Earth-like planet can therefore be used to determine whether the core is solid or liquid. For example, the variations in Mercury's rotational velocity are too great to be caused by a completely solid core, so its core, or parts of it, must be liquid. This is easily guessed. For the same applied force, a sphere filled completely with water will rotate faster than a similar sphere filled only halfway with water, where the liquid slips over the inner surface and, with its friction, resist rotation. The mass distribution of a planet can also be deduced by observing the movements of satellites, natural moons, or spacecraft in the planet's gravitational field. Any gravitational anomaly of the planet will indeed have well-detectable consequences on their orbital motion. Just to say, the GRACE mission, an acronym for Gravity Recovery and Climate Experiment, has orbited the Earth long enough, over 15 years, to even map decreases in the amount of Earth's ice near the poles and decreases in the amount of water in groundwater by pumping water for agriculture. But it's not just Earth, on the other planets too. From Mercury, with the Messenger probe, to Saturn, with Cassini, the method has worked great. Measurements and changes in velocities from NASA space probes orbiting Mars have been used to create maps of its gravitational field. And the Juno probe has done the same thing with Jupiter, arriving at interesting results about the nature of its core. Perhaps the most widely used in such research, however, is that of seismic wave analysis. Seismologists have already realized, for at least a century in fact, that seismographs, the graphs that record the course of seismic waves passing through the Earth in each direction, can be read as if they were X-rays of the planet. In other words, earthquakes travel through the planet as waves, and these waves travel at different speeds through different materials, and can also be reflected when they encounter a discontinuity in the layers. Seismic waves carry with them a range of information about the nature of the materials they have passed through, in the form of variations in their propagation velocity and the direction of their trajectories. In fact, their speed depends on the medium in which they propagate. Thanks to information gained from the study of seismic data, we now know that the Earth consists of concentric envelopes, which are made up of materials that differ in density and in the physical state in which they occur, solid or fluid. Such a technique has obviously been tested on our planet, and then on the Moon and Mars. So this is how we can make pretty good guesses about what the interiors of Mercury, Venus, Earth, Moon, and Mars look like. We can also use these methods to infer the internal structure of some of the best-studied moons in the outer solar system, Io, Europa, Ganymede, and Callisto. For gas giants, it's a bit more difficult because they do not tend to have distinct layers like rocky planets, Also, they are so huge that the pressures and temperatures in their inner depths are much greater than we can simulate in the lab. So we have to rely on theoretical predictions rather than actual data to understand how the materials involved behave. Anyway, here is in brief what we know today about the physical and chemical structure of the moon and the planets of the solar system. Mercury. Mercury's density of 5.4 grams per cubic centimeter is very close to Earth's. This suggests that despite its similarities to the moon, the planet's internal structure is more like that of Earth. While Earth's high density is the result of strong gravitational compression, Mercury is much smaller, and the inner regions are therefore less compressed than those on Earth. Therefore, such a high density assumes that the core must be relatively larger and iron-rich. Based on data from the Mariner 10 probe, it is assumed that Mercury's surface crust should be about 200 kilometers thick, and that underneath should extend for 600 kilometers a thick silicate mantle surrounding a large core 2,000 kilometers in radius, or perhaps even a double core with a solid central shell and an outer semi-fluid one. Relative to its diameter, Mercury has the largest core in the solar system with the highest iron content on the record. Hang on a sec, guys, before we continue. Be sure to join the Insane Curiosity channel. Click on the bell, you will help us to make products of even higher quality. Venus. Although there is little direct information about the Venusian internal structure due to the lack of seismic data, the similarities in size and density between Venus and Earth suggest that the two planets may have a similar internal structure, a core, mantle, and crust. The Venusian core, like Earth's, is believed to be at least partially liquid, since the two planets have undergone a similar cooling process. The main difference between the two planets is the absence on Venus of plate tectonics, which is probably due to the different composition of the Venusian lithosphere and mantle compared to Earth's. The absence of water leads to a higher viscosity and thus a higher degree of coupling between the crust and mantle. The Moon. During the various Apollo missions to the Moon, several instruments were left on the surface of our natural satellite, including seismographs, gravimeters, and magnetometers. These instruments transmitted for several years data that proved to be very useful in letting us know, at least in general terms, about its internal structure. From a seismological point of view, much weaker earthquakes occur on the Moon than on Earth, and are thought to be dependent on its position relative to Earth. In fact, lunar earthquakes occur twice a month. That is when the Moon is closer and farther away than our planet. The Moon's internal structure is similar to Earth. It consists of a core, the innermost layer, a mantle, the middle layer, and a crust, which represents the surface layer. The crust is thinner on the side facing Earth, where it averages about 60 kilometers thick, than on the opposite side, where it is about 100 kilometers thick. In it are the seas, having a thickness of 5 to 20 kilometers. The crust, together with the upper part of the mantle, forms the rigid lunar lithosphere, about 1,000 kilometers thick. The mantle consists of materials of higher density than the crust. Below the mantle is the plastic asthenosphere, which probably has a chemical composition similar to that of the mantle, but where the rocks are in a partially molten state. Thickness is about 350 kilometers. The core, with an estimated diameter of about 600 kilometers, is the portion of the Moon about which knowledge is most uncertain. It is assumed to consist at least partly of iron and nickel. Mars. The crust, mantle, and core of Mars formed within about 50 million years of the birth of the solar system and remained active for the first billion. The crust has an average thickness of 50 kilometers with a peak of 125 kilometers. Compared with Earth's crust, which has a thickness of about 40 kilometers, one could say that the Martian crust is three times thicker, considering it is twice the size of our planet. The mantle, which is denser than Earth's, is composed mainly of silicates and, although it is inactive, is the source of all tectonic and volcanic phenomena on the planet. The core is composed mainly of iron and nickel, with around 16% sulfur, and extends for a radius of about 1,800 kilometers. Most likely the core is solid, but in a viscous state. As a result, Mars has no appreciable magnetic field. This results in the lack of protection of the planet's soil from the activity of high-energy cosmic particles. Jupiter. It seems now established that Jupiter does not possess a solid crust. The atmospheric gas, almost entirely composed of hydrogen, with a small percentage of helium, ammonia, methane, sulfur, and hydrogen sulfide, becomes increasingly dense as it proceeds inward and gradually converts to a 20,000 kilometer thick layer of liquid molecular hydrogen. Almost total darkness dominates over this liquid ocean, barely ripped open by lightning flashed from the clouds above. At a depth of about 25,000 kilometers, at a pressure greater than 3 million atmospheres, the molecular liquid hydrogen transforms into metallic liquid hydrogen, that is a 37,000 kilometer thick mixture of protons and electrons. Descending even deeper to 63,000 kilometers, one should encounter a rocky core 12,000 kilometers in diameter, probably composed of iron silicates. The planet's core, with an estimated mass of 15 Earth masses, is often attributed to a rocky nature, but its detailed composition and even its very existence are still largely a matter of speculation. Indeed, on the nature of the core, a constant debate is open between those who claim a rocky core and those who deny it. However, the results of the Juno probe showed an inexplicably less dense and more extensive core than thought, which should be explained by a giant collision that occurred between Jupiter in formation and another celestial body about 4.5 billion years ago. Saturn. Saturn's internal structure is not much different from that of Jupiter, except for a more complete differentiation of the innermost layers. The center of the planet, where temperatures probably reach 15,000 degrees, there would be a rocky core of silicates and metals, surrounded by a shell of icy materials such as water and ammonia. Surrounding this solid core, which is expected to have a radius of nearly 15,000 kilometers, would extend a mantle of liquid hydrogen in which two layers would stand out. As on Jupiter, an inner layer of metallic hydrogen that is ionized hydrogen and an outer layer of molecular hydrogen. Above the ocean of liquid hydrogen extends the atmosphere. However, the transition from the liquid to the gas phase occurs gradually without a clear boundary. The results show how the core may not be entirely rocky, but more fuzzy, a kind of soup of ice, rock, and metal fluids that stretches across 60% of the planet's diameter, thus larger than classical theories. A surprising result, however, goes well with what has been inferred from the Juno probe's data on Jupiter, whose core seems similarly diluted. It is hard to imagine, but Saturn is the only planet in our solar system whose average density, 0.7 grams per cubic centimeter, is less than that of water. The giant gaseous planet could float in an ocean that was capable of containing it. Uranus. The structure of Uranus is similar to that of the inner part of Jupiter and Saturn. However, due to the lower mass, which is insufficient to generate the enormous pressures on these two planets, it lacks the liquid metallic hydrogen envelope. The material should also be more evenly distributed without the presence of a true rocky core. Uranus's core, however, is relatively small and not very massive. It also differs from that of the other giant planets in that it dissipates little heat. In astronomical terms, it has a low heat flux. It's not clear exactly why Uranus radiates little energy outward. One hypothesis put forward to explain this difference from other gas giants is that when Uranus was stuck in the body impact that caused its peculiar axial tilt, most of the original internal heat was expelled, significantly reducing the core temperature. Outside the core is a liquid mantle composed mainly of ice, methane, and ammonia, 7,500 kilometers thick, then a gaseous atmosphere, 7,600 kilometers thick, consisting mainly of hydrogen and helium, with a small portion of methane and traces of other gases, water and ammonia. Neptune. Neptune has a similar composition to Uranus and consists mainly of ice and rock, with about 15% hydrogen and a small part of helium. Its structure is similar to that of the inner part of Jupiter and Saturn. However, due to the lower mass, which is insufficient to generate the enormous pressures on these two planets, it lacks the liquid metallic hydrogen envelope, and the material should be more evenly distributed, with no clear distinction between the different layers. In the central part, however, there is a small iron core of rock and ice. And so, dear friends, it seems that we must also say goodbye to the imaginative possibility described by Jules Verne, that of being able to explore the interiors of the planets simply by following the immense cavities capable of leading us to their centers. The planets, as we have seen in this video, are huge spheres of very compact matter, and moreover, very hot. No hope of finding monsters, other worlds, and pretty girls in skimpy costumes there.